Harper Audio presents Coronado by Dennis Lehane, read by Stanley Tucci. Copyright 2006 by Dennis Lehane. Production copyright 2006 by HarperCollins Publishers. Running Out of Dog. This thing with Blue and the dogs and Elgin Byrne happened a while back, a few years after some of our boys, like Elgin Byrne and Cal Sears, came back from Vietnam, and a lot of others, like Eddie Vorey and Carl Joe Carroll, the Stewart cousins, didn't. We don't know how it worked in other towns, but that war put something secret in our boys who returned, something quiet and untouchable. You sense they knew things they'd never say, did things on the sly you'd never discover. Great card players, those boys, able to bluff with the best, let no joy show in their face no matter what they were holding. A small town is a hard place to keep a secret, and a small southern town with all that heat and all those open windows is an even harder place than most. But those boys who came back from overseas, they seem to have mastered the trick of privacy. And the way it's always been in this town, you get a sizable crop of young, hard men coming up at the same time. They sort of set the tone. So, not long after the war, we were a quieter town, a less trusting one, or so some seem to think. And that's right when tobacco money and textile money reached a sort of critical mass and created construction money, and pretty soon there was talk that our small town should maybe get a little bigger, maybe build something that would bring in more tourist dollars than we'd been getting from fireworks and pecans. That's when some folks came up with this Eden Falls idea. A big carnival-type park with roller coasters and water slides and such. Why should all those Yankees spend all their money in Florida? South Carolina had sun, too. Had golf courses and grapefruit, and no end of KOA campgrounds. So now a little town called Eden was going to have Eden Falls. We were going to be on the map, people said. We were going to be in all the brochures. We were small now, people said, but just you wait. Just you wait. And that's how things stood back then, the year Perkin and Jewel Lutz's marriage hit a few bumps, and Elgin Byrne took up with Shelley Briggs, and no one seemed able to hold on to their dogs. The problem with dogs in Eden, South Carolina, was that the owners who bred them bred a lot of them, or they allowed them to run free where they met up with other dogs of opposite gender and achieved the same result. This wouldn't have been so bad if Eden weren't so close to I-95, and if the dogs weren't in the habit of bolting into traffic and fucking up the bumpers of potential tourists. The mayor, Big Bobby Vargas, went to a mayoral conference up in Beaufort, where the governor made a surprise appearance to tell everyone how pissed off he was about this dog thing. A lot of money being poured into Eden these days, the governor said, a lot of steps being taken to change your image, and he for one would be goddamned if a bunch of misbehaving canines was going to mess all that up. Boys, he said, looking Big Bobby Vargas dead in the eye, they're starting to call this state the devil's kennel because of them pooch corpses along the interstate. And I don't know about you all, but I don't think that's a real pretty name. Big Bobby told Elgin and Blue he'd never heard anyone call it the devil's kennel in his life. Heard a lot worse, sure, but never that. Big Bobby said the governor was full of shit, but being the governor and all, he was sort of entitled. The dogs in Eden had been a problem going back to the 20s, and a part-time breeder named J. Mallon Ellenberg, who, if his arms weren't up to their elbows in the guts of the tractors and combines he repaired for a living, was usually lashing out at something, his family when they weren't quick enough, his dogs when the family was. J. Mallon Ellenberg's dogs were mixed breeds and mongrels, and they ran in packs, as did their offspring, and several generations later those packs still moved through the Eden night like wolves. Their bodies stripped to muscle and gristle, tense and angry, growling in the dark at J. Mallon Ellenberg's ghost. Big Bobby went to the trouble of measuring exactly how much of 95 crossed through Eden, and he came up with 2.8 miles. Not much, really, but still an average of 0.74 dog a day, or 4.9 dogs a week. Big Bobby wanted the rest of the state funds the governor was going to be doling out at year's end. And if that meant getting rid of 5 dogs a week, give or take, then that's what was going to get done. On the QT, he said to Elgin and Blue, on the QT, what we're going to do, boys, is set up in some trees and shoot every canine who gets within barking distance of that interstate. Elgin didn't much like this we stuff. First place, Big Bobby'd said we that time in double O's 4 years ago. This was before he'd become mayor, when he was nothing more than a county tax assessor who shot pool at double O's every other night, same as Elgin in blue. But one night, after Harlan and Chubb Uke had roughed him up over a matter of some pocket change, and knowing that neither Elgin nor Blue was too fond of the Uke family either, Big Bobby'd said, "We going to settle those boys' asses tonight," and started running his mouth the minute the brothers entered the bar. Time the smoke cleared, Blue had a broken hand, Harlan and Chubb were curled up on the floor, and Elgin's lip was busted. Big Bobby, meanwhile, was hiding under the pool table, and Cal Sears was asking who was going to pay for the pool stick Elgin had snapped across the back of Chubb's head. So Elgin heard Mayor Big Bobby saying we, and remembered the $10 it had cost him for that pool stick, and he said, "No, sir, you can count me out this particular enterprise." Big Bobby looked disappointed. Elgin was a veteran of a foreign war, former Marine, a marksman. "Shit," Big Bobby said. "What good are you? You don't use the skills Uncle Sam spent good money teaching you." Elgin shrugged. "Damn, Bobby, I guess not much." But Blue kept his hand in, as both Big Bobby and Elgin knew he would. All the job required was a guy didn't mind sitting in a tree who liked to shoot things. Hell, Blue was home. Elgin didn't have the time to be sitting up in a tree anyway. The past few months he'd been working like crazy after they'd broke ground at Eden Falls, mixing cement, digging post holes, draining swamp water to shore up the foundation, with the real work still to come. There'd be several more months of drilling and bilging, spreading cement like cake icing, and erecting scaffolding to erect walls to erect facades. There'd be the hump and grind of rolling along in the dump trucks and drill trucks, the forklifts and cranes and industrial diggers, until the constant heave and jerk of them drove up his spine or into his kidneys like a corkscrew. Time to sit up in a tree shooting dogs? Shit, Elgin didn't have time to take a piss some days. And then on top of all the work, he'd been seeing Drew Briggs' ex-wife Shelley lately. Shelley was the receptionist at Perkin Lutz Auto Emporium, and one day Elgin had brought his Impala in for a tire rotation and they'd got to talking. She'd been divorced from Drew over a year, and they waited a couple of months to show respect, but after a while they began showing up at Double O's and down at the IHOP together. Once, they drove clear to Myrtle Beach together for the weekend. People asked them what it was like, and they said, just like the postcards. Since the postcards never mentioned the price of a room at the Hilton, Elgin and Shelley didn't mention that all they'd done was drive up and down the beach twice before settling in a motel a bit west in Conway. Nice, though. Had a color TV and one of those switches turned the bathroom into a sauna if you let the shower run. They'd started making love in the sauna, finished up on the bed with steam coiling out from the bathroom and brushing their heels. Afterward, he pushed her hair back off her forehead and looked in her eyes and told her he could get used to this. She said, "But wouldn't it cost a lot to install a sauna in your trailer?" Then waited a full 30 seconds before she smiled. Elgin liked that about her, the way she let him know he was still just a man after all, always would take himself too seriously, part of his nature. Letting him know she might be around to keep him apprised of that fact every time he did. Keep him from pushing a bullet into the breech of a .30-06, slamming the bolt home, firing into the flank of some wild dog. Sometimes when they'd shut down the site early for the day, if it had rained real heavy and the soil loosened near a foundation, or if supplies were running late, he'd drop by Lutz to see her. She'd smile as if he'd brought her some flowers, say, caught boozing on the job again, or some other smart-ass thing, but it made him feel good, as if something in his chest suddenly realized it was free to breathe. Before Shelley, Elgin had spent a long time without a woman he could publicly acknowledge as his. He'd gone with May Schiller from 15 to 19, but she'd gotten lonely while he was overseas, and he'd returned to find her gone from Eden, married to a boy up in south of the border, the two of them working a corn dog concession stand, making a tidy profit, folks said. Elgin dated some, but it took him a while to get over May, to get over the loss of something he'd always expected to have, the sound of her laugh and an image of her stepping naked from Cooper's Lake, her pale flesh beaded with water, having been the things that got Elgin through the jungle, through the heat, through the ticking of his own death he'd heard in his ears every night he'd been over there. About a year after he'd come home, Jewel Lutt had come to visit her mother, who still lived in the trailer park where Jewel had grown up with Elgin and Blue, where Elgin still lived. On her way out, she'd dropped by Elgin's, and they'd sat out front of his trailer in some folding chairs, had a few drinks, talked about old times. He told her a bit about Vietnam, and she told him a bit about marriage, how it wasn't what you expected, how Perkin Lutt might know a lot of things, but he didn't know a damn sight about having fun. There was something about Jewel Lutt that sank into men's flesh the way heat did. It wasn't just that she was pretty, had a beautiful body, moved in a loose, languid way that made you picture her naked no matter what she was wearing. No, there was more to it. Jewel, never the brightest girl in town, and not even the most charming, had something in her eyes that none of the women Elgin ever met had. It was a capacity for living, for taking moments, no matter how small or inconsequential, and squeezing every last thing you could out of them. Jewel gobbled up life, dove into it like it was a cool pond cut in the shade of a mountain on the hottest day of the year. That look in her eyes, the one that never left, said, "Let's have fun, goddammit. Let's eat. Now." She and Elgin hadn't been stupid enough to do anything that night, not even after Elgin caught that look in her eyes, saw it was directed at him, saw she wanted to eat. Elgin knew how small Eden was, how people loved to insinuate and pry and talk. So he and Jewel worked it out, a once-a-week thing mostly that happened down in Carlisle, at a small cabin, had been in Elgin's family since before the war between the states. There, Elgin and Jewel were free to partake of each other, squeeze and bite and swallow and inhale each other, to make love in the lake, on the porch, in the tiny kitchen. They hardly ever talked, and when they did, it was about nothing at all, really. The decline in the quality of the meat at Billy's butcher shop, rumors that parking meters were going to be installed in front of the courthouse, if McGarrett and the rest of 5-0 would ever put the cuffs on Woe Fat. There was an unspoken understanding that he was free to date any woman he chose and that she'd never leave Perkin Lutt, and that was just fine. This wasn't about love. It was about appetite. Sometimes Elgin would see her in town or hear Blue speak about her in that puppy dog love way he'd been speaking about her since high school, and he'd find himself surprised by the realization that he slept with this woman, that no one knew, that it could go on forever if both of them remained careful, vigilant against the wrong look, the wrong tone in their voices when they spoke in public. He couldn't entirely put his finger on what need she satisfied, only that he needed her in that lakefront cabin once a week, that it had something to do with walking out of the jungle alive, with the ticking of his own death he'd heard for a full year. Jewel was somehow reward for that, a fringe benefit. To be naked and spent with her atop him, and seeing that look in her eyes that said she was ready to go again, ready to gobble him up like oxygen. He'd earned that by shooting at shapes in the night, pressed against those damp foxhole walls that never stayed shored up for long, only to come home to a woman who couldn't wait, who discarded him as easily as she would a once-favored doll she'd grown beyond, looked back upon with a wistful mix of nostalgia and disdain. He'd always told himself that when he found the right woman, his passion for Jewel, his need for those nights at the lake, would disappear. And truth was, since he'd been with Shelley Briggs, he and Jewel had cooled it. Shelley wasn't Perkin, he told Jewel. She'd figure it out soon enough if he left town once a week, came back with bite marks on his abdomen. Jewel said, "Fine, we'll get back to it whenever you're ready," knowing there'd be a next time, even if Elgin wouldn't admit it to himself. So Elgin, who'd been so lonely in the year after his discharge, now had two women. Sometimes he didn't know what to think of that. When you were alone, the happiness of others boiled your insides. Beauty seemed ugly. Laughter seemed evil. The casual grazing of one lover's hand into another was enough to make you want to cut them off at the wrist. "I will never be loved," you said. "I will never know joy." He wondered sometimes how Blue made it through. Blue, who'd never had a girlfriend, he hadn't rented by the half hour, who was too ugly and small and just plain weird to evoke anything in women but fear or pity. Blue, who'd been carrying a torch for Jewel Lutt since long before she married Perkin, and kept carrying it with a quiet fever Elgin could only occasionally identify with. Blue, he knew, saw Jewel Lutt as a queen, as the only woman who existed for him in Eden, South Carolina, all because she'd been nice to him, pals with him in Elgin, back about 1,000 years ago, before sex, before breasts, before Elgin or Blue had even the smallest clue what that thing between their legs was for, before Perkin Lutt had come along with his daddy's money and his nice...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.